What is the scene, guys? Welcome back to another edition of What's the Scene Hangouts. And today I'm talking to the awesome Shalini Mohan. Shalini Mohan is an amazing bass guitarist based in Bangalore and also a very good vocalist. And today I'm hoping to talk to her about her music and a whole bunch of other things.
I had joined Wipro after my engineering, and there was a Wipro band, and I auditioned for a backing vocalist. And I think during a couple of days before our first gig, the actual bass player didn't turn up. I mean, absconded. So full panic situation, and they just dumped this huge thing on me. And before that, I was just comfortable with the piano. I hadn't even touched a guitar. So it was very new, and I fell in love with the sound though, because I have been fortunate enough to be born with a sense of music. So I immediately knew, like, even though I hadn't played the bass before, I immediately knew where it fit in a song or music, you know. So, and that was fantastic for me. So after I picked up the bass, I did play the guitar. I did do a lot of my music theory, but somehow an instrument that doesn't have the lower register for me didn't achieve that. So I just came back to the bass, and I must say that a lot of Rehman songs at that time, like Tamil movies especially, they have fantastic bass lines. So, and I didn't think that a bass could be played like that. And I think a few bass lines from Mr. Keith Peters. So I was like, yeah, I have to get better at this. And that is, it became my thing. I learned everything I could from YouTube. And again, it was Wipro, you know, because we had the internet access, and before that, I didn't know what YouTube was. You know, I just clicked on it, and every possible video was there. So initially, I had 1 month where I just went on watching American Idol. I don't know why. And then I realized I could use it for better purposes. And then the bass lessons are fantastic. Like, when I learned, it was chaos, actually, because I started picking up songs by ear, the songs I liked. So there was no particular genre of songs that I wanted to learn. So my first bass line, what I learned was Sabbath's, what's that song? Then I picked up a Rehman song. So it was just bits and pieces here and there. And then I think when I got a little better at it and started writing my exams, that's when reading music came in. Then I discovered more artists and spent more time on learning more difficult things. So the initial learning curve was like this, and then it slowly came out like that. But I think that's how it always is. So no structure, but now it's structured. Some of the students, they give you ideas, you know, because not everyone is the same. And you do treat every student as an individual and, you know, have lessons as per what they are capable of, what they like, and how their ear is. And so you learn a lot of things from people who are not as, I wouldn't say jaded, but when you're a professional musician for so long, you do tend to get jaded with a few sounds, you know. So these new bass players, musicians who are coming up, they have a totally new perspective, and that, like, you'll be like, oh yeah. So it's quite cool. You practice for an hour and you feel like the greatest bass player after that. No. It's always unsatisfying, and there's always more to do the next day. So now what I do when I start my practice, like, no matter what the schedule or what my home responsibilities are, I try to dedicate at least 1 or 2 hours every day. So what I do start, and what I do tell my students, is that if you don't practice with a metronome, nothing matters, you know, especially as a bass player. So how I do start with is, there are some rudimentaries for my left hand and my right hand, the exercises that I have come up and I've learned from people, from YouTube, that I've put together, and which I choose a bit from for each day. And based on a click or a metronome, I start off with these finger practices. So that goes on for at least 15 minutes. And then say I do have a list of songs that I think help me get my fingers warmed up. And then the next list of songs that I have that I need to learn how to play. You know, so I have my exercises. I have my fun time where I play songs I already know. And then I have my list of songs that I know that will help me get my technique better. So that's my flow, actually. Exercise, have fun, then practice, and feel unsatisfied. Especially as a bass player, like, the people who have made a mark, and you see their videos, and they are playing such flashing solos and, you know, great technique, whatever technique you could think of, you know, ghost notes, tapping, slapping, everything, you know. And everyone wants to do that. You do want to shine. But especially as a bass player, I think you have to lay down a foundation for the rest of the band to have fun with, you know. Because no matter how great the other musicians might be, the vocalist, the keyboardist, the guitarist, whoever it is, if the bassist and the drummer, if they do not connect, the band is going to sound very loose. So, there is no mantra to lock with a drummer. So yes, as a beginner or an intermediate person, you do lock with a kick. You do provide that. And then you do lock with a snare. And then you do lock with everything else. But first of all, you should like your drummer, okay? I mean... And then, listen to the drummer. Sometimes when I go into a song, or even if it's my band where we have composed a song, I go in with these ideas and I was like, yeah, let's do this. And then I'm like, and it's like, just sounds like shit. You know, so, and luckily with Ginny and the Bottle, we have a fantastic drummer called Dilushan, and he plays with Lucky Ali, and he's brilliant. So I get to lock with him by listening to what he plays. And he will play a lot of things, but there will be a basic rhythm that will be going on. So I first lock with that. Then I decide where I want to fill in the spaces. It's also very important to know when to keep quiet. So then you lock with the drummer and then do everything else that you want.
And this whole thing about self-belief has been very, very difficult for me. So as a person, I have always had trouble believing in myself. And that has unfortunately reflected a lot in my playing over the years, you know. So even though I would be practicing, getting my chops down, trying to get better as much as I can, playing with wonderful artists, I would always hesitate to show off. I don't know how else to put it. So I would always hesitate to step forward and be evident. I don't know. Because honestly speaking, when I fell in love with the bass, one of the things I loved about it is that I could stand at the back of the drummer and just vibe and let everybody else do whatever they wanted. So, but over the years, this self-belief has become stronger. I have never tried to be cool. I couldn't because it was a bit of a hindrance for me. This self-belief has become much better. And weirdly enough, this lockdown has given me a lot of perspective on a lot of things. And yeah. I think I will come out a much bolder person than I was. So people might think I've been very bored because of how I dress. And I am in a band and, you know, all that stuff. But actually, I'm not. I mean, I wasn't. I'm still not, but I'm much better now. But so this, how it affected my playing is that the tones I chose would be very personal, you know. So I would look at videos from Stu Hamm, Victor Wooten, a lot of people, and they would have such aggressive, lovely tones. But when I would use that tone and play, it would feel very fake because I wasn't aggressive as a person. I wasn't loud as a person. So even if you see my old videos where I put up some slap bass, you will not see that, you know, that typical pop in your face thing. So it was always subdued, more mellow. But over the years, I think I have become more pretty. So my playing style is very connected to who I am inside. So if I feel like shit inside, I'm not going to be able to translate that onto my bass, you know, that whole
absolutely
wall is there. So I think for the past 1 year, at least one year, I have worked with some fantastic people. Like, I mean, first, of course, I have my, the Moksha group and all that, Dev Jeet and Richard, who was there. But I've also played with artists like Ranjit Parekh and Suresh Peters, and in which I have come forward and I have shown people my chops. So I think it's getting better. So the day I feel that I'm like, yeah, man, I'm brave, I think that would be my peak sound tone. Not my playing, but my sound. So who I am is what I play on the bass. It's not always been good, but now it's good.
That was such an interesting answer. Wow. Okay. It was absolutely amazing. Yeah. And it's so cool to hear about how you're feeling on a day can affect your tone. So I think that's fascinating. You've been jamming with your band, Jenny and the Bottle, and you've also been working in sessions and you're working on your own EP. So quite a few of us, myself included, are quite keen to hear about when we can expect to hear this new music, what's in the pipeline, what's coming up.
EP. The name we have decided is called Nasha, but that might change. And we have recorded all our songs. There are going to be 5 songs in the EP, and we have a wonderful Carnatic vocalist called Abhijit, who also sings with me. You know, he sings Hindi and the Carnatic vocals, because when I sing Hindi, I sound like, I don't know, foreign mein Hindi bahut hota hai, so. So when I sing in Hindi, I've tried YouTube with me singing in Hindi, so it either sounds too foreign or too Tamil. So I do the English vocals in my band. Abhijit, he does the regional vocals. I also do the rap, and he does the Carnatic bit. So I think that's a beautiful balance. And we've been together for 2 years now, and somehow it's got a lovely progressive rock feel to it. But I think,
nice.
Yeah, I mean, that's something I've always wanted to do. And my guitarist, Sridhar, he actually pushed the sound towards that, and I totally loved it, you know. Because my thing, if you look at it, my personal thing is funk, and I'm getting into jazz. But when I go to do progressive rock and just, you know, belt it out and sing while playing the bass, it just brought out a lot from me that, you know, I individually wouldn't have pushed myself to do. So it is a progressive rock album with a lot of Carnatic elements and, of course, Western elements. It's got 5 songs. It's called Nasha, and it should be out in a month.
Awesome.
Yes. Yeah.
You said progressive rock and you said funk, and I just cannot wait now. Just cannot wait.
Also a little scary, but yeah, it's good.
You've got accolades for singing as well, and you sing a lot. And you recently completed grade level exams. So my question is, as someone who sings and plays bass guitar, how do both those skills work complementarily in your making of music and your musical journey?
So one thing I realized, especially as a session musician, like it's a huge add-on if you do sing with your instrument. Like, you don't have to be the lead vocalist. But ever since I was younger, right? Like, I used to sing in the choir. I used to sing in churches. And, you know, because that kind of music really spoke to me. The concept of harmonies is so deeply, imbibed in that kind of music. So that's what I learned growing up. You know, harmonies and singing with other people.
Yeah.
So when I think of the bass, what a lot of people don't realize is the bass is also a beautiful harmony instrument. So yes, you do lock with the drummer. You do also, sometimes you play with the drummer, sometimes you play with the guitarist, and sometimes you bridge both of them together, right? And one of the really nice things I learned over the past few years from this producer called Hriday, who's very well known in the circuit, he would actually record all the instruments, the drums, guitarists, even the vocals, and he would record the bass right at the end. You know, and that's something I had never, you know, usually people start with the drums, they play the bass, and then they put in all the instruments. That's the normal way of doing things, I guess. But he would record the bass in the end, and I realized a lot of producers around would do the same thing, because whenever you play a bass on the note, or if a guitarist plays a chord, you will not know what chord it is until I play the note and make it the complete chord. Yeah?
Absolutely.
So the same thing holds your voice. So when you are playing the bass, and you might not exactly be playing the root, or you might not exactly be playing the progression the guitarist is playing. You might actually be playing a harmony. And when you can hear that and play it on the bass with the other instruments, you can do the same with your voice. So it took me a while, actually. It actually, unlike instruments like the keyboard or the guitar, when you have to sing with a bass, you actually have to split your head into two. Because you have to deal with a rhythm and what the guitarist is playing. And you have to sing, which will be totally in a different plane. And it might not even be going with what you're playing on the bass, you know? So, like Rush, like that guy is like insane. So,
Geddy Lee, yeah.
It's a personal challenge for me to do it. And I get to do that with my band, Ginny and the Body, because they tolerate me quite a bit. And providing harmonies for me was easy because I learned a lot about harmony with singing in the church, and I learned about a lot of harmony from my bass. So that actually pushed me to sing. I actually used to sing a lot, but I stopped singing when I joined my engineering. So there was a good 10 years when I didn't open my mouth, actually. So there was a lot of...
Oh, really?
I was terrified of singing. So even like at home, or if my friends asked me to sing, or if one friend asked me to sing, I wouldn't sing until they sang with me. So that was my fight, to sing. And 3 years ago, when I started Ginny and the Bottle, I was like, I play the bass, I have the harmonies in my head, I have music in my head, and I do have a voice. And I felt that I should push myself. And there is one person who really, really helped me. Her name is Nisia. She's a fantastic teacher. I think she's one of the best vocal teachers in India. And she gave me some tools that would reduce my fright a bit. And she's actually pushed me. And I'm nowhere close to being as good as I want to be with my voice. But it's getting there.
Awesome.
But yeah.
I said...
My pants when I have to sing on stage, but it's far better.
Well, what would you describe your natural voice as being? Do you have more of a soprano voice or an alto? Where do you, how do you usually fit into a choir setup?
Soprano voice. So, okay. You know, most earlier, before I met Nisia, most of my attempts at singing would be a very falsetto head voice.
Mm-hmm.
And I had no chest voice. I had no power from my stomach. But now the tools are there. I still have a soprano voice because I have that range, but I know how to pack it with a little bit of fat, you know, give that substance. It's getting there.
Lovely. I really liked what you said as a tip for bass players and how they can sort of understand their approach to the instrument. Because when you said using bass as a tool to harmonize, I think many people don't think of it that way. And I think it's a fabulous tip. So thank you, all you bass players watching. And you budding bass players, look at it that way as well, because you really totally can use bass as a tool to harmonize. It's fantastic. And that's a great piece of insight from you, Shalini. Thank you. So you picked up the bass in your mid-20s-ish. You've been, at a time when many people consider it being too late to start playing an instrument. And since then, you've, learned an entire new instrument, and you've also moved to being someone who does music full-time as a career. So my question over here is, what advice can you share with those people looking to make the change or looking to start late? What can you share in terms of making the rubber hit the road and actioning, translating desire to action and making it real?
You just translate desire to action. There has to be action. That's it. And there's a very clear difference between enjoying music when you listen to it on headphones and performing it and making it your breadwinner. They are totally two different things, you know. So I might be someone who can't wake up without having a song. So I might be someone who would want to listen to songs all day. But I might not be someone who can translate that to an instrument or to a profession. So one, I think personally, someone who should have a clarity. You should have a clarity if you love music or if you want to make it a profession. Because when you do make it a profession, you do get to see some ugly sides of things. You don't always get to play what you want. Mm-hmm. Even when I have gone for recordings for movies, some of the songs have been dreadful. But you do record those songs because it is your job. So, and as a musician in India, unfortunately, more often than not, unless you're someone like Vishal Dadlani or at the top, you know, right at the top, I don't think you can be picky all the time. You can be picky about what you work with, but you can't be picky all the time about what you work with. So these are the things you must anticipate. And yeah, you have to build your skill set. Because otherwise, like for me personally, when I was working in Wipro, I knew I wasn't good enough to take it full time yet. So even though I was working in a corporate job, like even when I shifted to SAP Labs, and I would be writing code all day, and I would be doing my exams and my gigs in the evening. So even then, I wasn't sure whether I would, you know, take the leap forward, because there's always an insecurity of not having a paycheck at the end of the day.
Yeah.
Always the insecurity of how will you start off, even though you've been gigging and you've had your connections. How will you manage your time at home when you don't have a job? You know, all those things come. So it's a very personal choice that you have to make. But the common factor is that you have to build your skill set before you do anything full time. So especially with art, which is already not a mainstream here, fields with art, like not just music, photography, painting, writing, I think you have to build your skill set and then take a leap. I don't think I could have done it earlier than I did, even though I wanted to.
That's right. So there you have it. Folks who've asked this question before, now you know how you can make the transition, act on it and build your skill set and then make your dreams come true.
People coming and asking me, hey, what should we do, you know, to get better? We just practice. Like, yeah, but anything else? No, just practice.
Amen. How difficult is it to financially sustain making original music?
Sorry if I'm breaking the bubble there. So personally for me, I wouldn't have been able to, like even with Lagori, right? Mm-hmm. We wrote a lot of our own songs. We had an album and we would perform them. But for live shows, people would still ask for a balance. Have your own stuff and then have a few covers, especially for corporate shows. And if you are looking to make money in the music business, as much as live shows give you money, it would be corporate shows and college shows. But more often than not, they would ask you for something that they already have.
Right.
Yeah, so if you're keen on making your originals heard, initially what, in my opinion, if you're earning money through, because whatever said and done, corporate gigs and college gigs pay a lot. You know, when compared to festivals and pub gigs, as much as we would not like to admit it. And this is a truth out there. So if you do want to push your original music forward, I think for me, in my opinion, we start off with a balance where we do play what people want and then, you know, put in our songs, sneak in our songs. And slowly, when the crowd starts to get more familiar with your work and stuff, shift the balance. So have a 60 to 40, have 60% of your own songs and 40% of what they want. And then finally, when you're, I don't know, like the Rolling Stones or something, just listen to my music, nothing else. So it is possible, but initially it's not going to be financially great. But if you really are keen and passionate about getting your own music forward, then start off with a ratio. My own music, what everybody else wants, and then, you know, change the ratio according to what you want as time goes.
Right. And like you so rightly pointed out in your previous answer, when I asked you about sort of how you approach playing the bass and how you develop your skills, you said a lot of the time you play music you don't want to play. You're actually doing many times. And you're playing songs that you're not really enjoying. So I guess to make the dream work, sometimes you've got to do things you can't always do things that you want to do. You've got to... meet people halfway. So you are an absolute icon for bass players and musicians, and especially for female musicians. Have you faced any challenges in the industry being a woman?
Yeah.
Can you tell us about a few of them? All right, there you are. Lost you for a second. Yeah, so we're talking about the challenges being a woman, and you just shared a few. You were talking about how, you know, people will call you a very good female bass player, but won't call you a good bass player. And so there always is a sort of qualifier. And then I think when we stopped, you were talking about how people will not stand up for you because if there's, if especially with guys, if there's another friend bullying, very often they just let it slide.
No, I just put it in one sentence that personally for me, I think for a woman in general, it takes a lot more effort to prove yourself than for a man. I mean, I know I'll have haters and I know people will say no, feminism, this and that. But there's a reason feminism is around. It's because we need to be equal. And even now in 2020, it's quite tough.
Yeah.
So especially if you're someone who wants to be who you want and look how you want, you know, people are always going to judge. And very often, not many people would ask a man in his mid-30s on where he is in life, you know. But a lot of people ask me about, why don't you start a family? Why don't, you know, how long are you going to be on stage? When you get older and you don't look nice and you become older, you know, would people still want you performing? Would people still want you on stage? And I don't think a man would get asked all that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're right.
But I get asked all the time. Yeah.
That's really unfortunate. But it's been amazing to see how you actually, you know, pushed past all those comments. And in a sense, I guess it's probably is water off a duck's back now. Do you feel like you're unaffected for the large part, for the most part?
When you mention women, if a woman is able to cross those hurdles and still make a name for herself, she's going to be really, really, really strong. So, I mean, if there are any women out there, if you're really passionate about it, it's going to be hard. But after a while, it's going to be awesome.
Right. And I want to take this opportunity, guys who are watching, if you have friends who are musicians and female, please stand up for them, support them. And don't say nice things to them only in the context of being female musicians, because I'm sure they're building their chops. So please, guys, we've got to stand up for the women in our lives. Not just the women musicians in our lives, but all the women in our lives. So I'd love to see your experience change over the years.
Sorry. I wouldn't say most of the people I have worked with in the industry are fantastic.
That's great to hear.
I just want to put that out there because there are people out there who are amazing and who are not threatened, who are secure in their own, you know, system.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, there are a few bad apples, but you can't do anything about that.
Right. Yeah. Thanks for saying that. Nice of you to qualify. So since I said that, I want to also ask you what's been good for you as a female musician. So you just talked about the flip side, but has there been anything that you feel by virtue of being a female musician, it has given you sort of experiences you probably wouldn't have had, or given you a perspective that us male musicians don't have?
I don't know. I don't think so. In terms of skill, chops, anybody who works hard enough,
mm-hmm.
Will get what they want, I hope. An advantage of being a female musician, I don't see any advantage. But one thing, yes, I think as women, we are more in tune with our emotions. Because unfortunately, our culture raises men and women differently that way, you know. Men can't cry, but women should be softer, and that's that kind of things. So in general, in here, I think women are more in tune with their emotions than men are. So if there is a woman who is working on her art, no painting, whatever it is, she's bound to be more honest with it, you know, put more emotion, put more into what she's playing. So maybe that's right. One small advantage, but I have seen some men who do that amazingly and give me goosebumps when they just pick up their instruments.
Tell us about your paintings.
So I used to always sketch in black and white. I have put up some of my work on Facebook, on social media.
Mm-hmm.
But last year in September, I had a bit of a nervous breakdown and a lot of perspective changed about how I look at things. And there would be reasons why I would only sketch in black and white. But after last September, I just started painting in color. You know, it was the first time I was picking up a brush and painting. And it didn't look quite bad. So it's still a very new thing for me, something I'm still, you know, diving into. Because I even the way I dress, it would mostly be black. Hello. Yeah. You know, blacks, grays, browns. I'm not someone who's very colorful on the outside. But when I started painting, it was extremely therapeutic. I don't know. Just the smell of fresh paint, you know. I tried using the iPad and all that, but the physical contact with the paint and the brush on paper and the smell, it was wonderful. So I can't talk much about it because it's still very new. And there have been paintings I've put up on social media, but yeah, it's good.
Just a few seconds ago, you said, I started painting in color and it was not too bad. And the reason I'm rephrasing that is because I want to ask you what it's like being an artist. Do you consider yourself a perfectionist who's rarely happy with the work you put out?
I'm never happy with the work I put out. I cannot even go back and look at my own videos. And if I have to hear myself cringe, my kidneys die. I mean, they just collide and everything goes inside. So I never do it. Yeah. I record, I think, I express, I put it out there. I don't go back to it. Honestly, I don't.
Yeah, I can personally relate to that as well. I have that feeling sometimes as well. I'm primarily wanting to get a sense of whether there are moments when you feel, that was really good work. I'm happy with how this turned out. So is it more like in the moment when you think, okay, this is good, and then when you go back to it, you feel like could have done better? Is that how it works out?
Not exactly. I think I do give whatever I can, if it's a recording or even a live performance or whatever it is. But the thought of having to hear myself back and the possibility of realizing that I suck, it's something that I want to just keep away for a little while. So, but with my band, it's good work. It's everybody's involvement. So that's different. If it's only my personal work, I don't look back. I record, I express, I perform, I let it go.
Cool. I didn't know until I read on Wikipedia that you are the grandniece of the celebrated flautist T.R. Mahalingam, who founded the contemporary style of playing the flute in Carnatic music. So has this sort of heritage and the legacy that he's passed on sort of affected your music and your style and had an influence on the music you make?
It's only very recently that I found out how great a man he was.
Mm-hmm.
So my family, we haven't, my immediate family, we aren't very musically oriented. Although I personally was. So I would always wonder where it came from. So I didn't know this person called T.R. Mahalingam existed. I would see an album of his in my uncle's house. I didn't know he was my great uncle. But I never knew what he was, you know. So about 4 years back, I did take the help of Wikipedia myself. I started doing a lot of research on him, the kind of contribution he's made to the music here, the South Indian Carnatic music, the way he has redesigned the flute, adding another hole in it, the way he created a percussive style of playing the flute, otherwise which was just a very legato Hindustani, you know, thing that everybody was used to. And I was abogasted. I'm like, I'm related to this man. And I had I knew I was related, but I'm related to this man, this legend who once refused a Padma Bhushan award because he didn't believe in all that, you know, he just wanted to make his music. So that pushed me to get better more because I think I owed it to him. And believe it or not, after that, I started doing, I went out of my comfort zone and I started learning and working with a lot of fantastic Carnatic musicians. Because I wanted to know, I felt it was too late for me to start from scratch. So what I do is, if I'm working with Carnatic musicians, I transpose what they are telling me into the knowledge I have and I perform with them, you know, because I feel that's the way I need to go right now. And in fact, there was this wonderful project called Project Maya I was a part of last year with Karthik Mani and a lot of people, and it was brilliant. So initially, you know, in my high school, or when I was working, or even when I took the leap to be a professional, I wasn't in tune with Carnatic music at all.
Yeah.
I mean, it was zilch. It was nothing. I knew nothing. I could, even when I heard it, it made me feel nothing, you know. But ironically, when I found out about my own grandfather and what he was, it just pushed me to do some justice to the kind of genes he's put inside me. I mean, there is a reason that I would wake up with a song in my head and the way I can relate to music, you know, and it comes from him. So my way of doing justice and thanking him is to learn more about Carnatic music. So I have been performing in a lot more Carnatic setups than I used to. I enjoy a lot more Carnatic music than I used to. And right now I have a project called Metronome Station, where it's an all-women's project. So there's a fantastic Carnatic vocalist, a fantastic ghatam player. She is amazing. A brilliant drummer called Priya. So we have this Carnatic fusion thing that we want to actually push forward. We released a video on Mother's Day, and it did really well. So yeah, I think he's responsible for it, Mahalingam. I think he is making me a better musician.
Lovely. There was one thing you said that caught my attention as well while you were answering. And you said, when I work with Carnatic musicians, I transpose their knowledge to be able to work with them. So what is that process like? Because you're speaking in the same language of music, but it's different ways of articulating that knowledge. So what's it like to fuse those two styles and to come up with a method of working together? How does that play out?
So from my experience, the Carnatic music as such is very, it's set. I wouldn't say rigid, but it is set. So there are rags that you can only perform in a certain way. You cannot change those things. There are scales you cannot, you know, play around with. So if you play a single note extra or don't play a note, it's completely something else.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you do fusion with Carnatic musicians, more often than not, it's you blending into their style and adding your own flavor rather than the other way around because of how the music styles work. So when they say they are playing Raag Todi or whichever Raag they are in and the time signatures or whatever phrases they use, terminologies they use, I map it to the terminologies I've studied in my Western theory.
Yeah.
And I try and fuse with them. Because if they say Raag, give me a name of a Raag and say let's jam on it, I'll be clueless. So I would first sit with them, ask them what they mean, note down everything, and then I will do what I have.
Great. For those of you contemplating partnerships and working with people in the Carnatic space, this is one way to do it. You can consider doing it this way, especially if you're merging the worlds of Western and Carnatic. If you could give some golden advice and tips on how to network well and working with fantastic musicians, given the fact that one has a decent skill set, what would you recommend? What are some tips for how to network in sort of work with different musicians?
Just approach them. See, right now, what worked for me, social media has been a big boon. I think with platforms like YouTube, people from across the world can see what you can play. And this would have been impossible like 15 years ago. Like, I can't even imagine how people before the internet would network and...
I know, right? Know, yeah.
Yes, it's crazy. Like madness. It's madness. Like, how do you tell people that you can do this before the internet, you know? You'll have to go meet them personally, physically travel, probably save up money, take a flight, go to the recording label, show your albums, record it at home, go and take them, show physical copies. We don't have to do any of that. It's a lot easier now than it was for the previous generation, you know? So just put up your work on social media. And if you think you want to work with someone, approach them, because that's what I did. And I can't release too many details right now, but during this lockdown, I did approach the producer of who I consider the best music director in India. I approached my friend who I thought could help me approach the producer and not the man directly. But I was shocked to receive an email from the man directly the next day. saying that he like, yeah. And I can't really, So I when I received that email from him, I was shaking. So I will be meeting him after the lockdown. And that's because I approached, I don't mind asking for work, I mean, I don't think there is anything beneath you to approach people and say, hey, I can do this. How about working together?
Absolutely. Yeah.
If they say no, if they say you're not good enough, it's okay.
That's a great attitude.
Yeah. So that's it. Just use social media, put up your stuff, approach people. That's it.
I will sort of piggyback on the question and add my own layer to it, which is, do you feel like you have to jam with people before you decide to work with them, or are you open to collaborations, you know, with people just by virtue of the fact that there's some common interest?
As a session musician, you don't often get to jam too much. So sometimes, especially when I did a gig a few months back in Gujarat, and some of the musicians I was meeting for the first time. So the opportunity to jam wasn't there. So we had one practice session in a room, in the hotel room, saying this is what we'll do. And I think you should be in a position to be able to do that. So sometimes you get to jam with the musicians, you get the vibe, you bond, and then you have a few jams. With your band, of course, you do jam. The band is a totally different thing. It's like a family. You make music together. But if you are being a session musician, meeting people for the first time, it can go either ways. You can have 3-4 jams, you can have 10 jams, or you can have none. So I've worked in both the scenarios. I've loved the fact that I could jam with people before playing the gig. I get to know what they are. That's one of the best things I love about being a session musician, because I get to know what people are with the way they play their music. It's amazing.